our project and accordingly use it. Because when I was designing it, so I broadly designed it for everyone, irrespective of the fact what the student will do. So it's a broad template covering almost everything. If something has left out, you can talk to your supervisor on the right and accordingly add it. So make sure we complete the project, because 30th is the last date and no date beyond that. That is what we have as well. So make sure if we are able to achieve it as such. So is the voice not clear? That is what Monica is saying. Are we not able to hear? Are we able to hear the voice properly or not? Minute disturbance, it's okay. So we can start off with the things. So let us now see the second part of the dependency injection. So we have discussed in the last lecture regarding the Spring framework. And the Spring framework was the first framework regarding Java programming language, which introduced the two kinds of the dependency injections. First was the constructor-based dependency injection, and second one was the setter-based dependency injection. Now, what was dependency injection? If you want to recap some of the facts which we discussed, was that traditionally, object-oriented programming languages have been emphasizing on the fact that the calling function will always make a call to the called function. And then only the called function will trigger, or it will get activated and will execute the program and give the desired output. So, Rod Johnson from the Spring framework decided to change the things. He said, why it is always the calling function that makes a call to the called function? Why not the called function be always in the ready state to give its desired output to the calling function? It's something like if I'm entering a mall, or if I'm entering a showroom or departmental store. So earlier what used to happen, we used to have the doors. So you need to pull the door to make an entry. Nowadays we have got sliding doors with the sensors fitted with them. So the moment they detect the object motion, they come to know that here the person is about to enter in or about to go out of the shop. So doors move out and the person can easily move in or move out. So that is what the objective is. Because providing a life of comfort to the object, providing a life of comfort to the user. So here in this case, the user does not have to pull out the door or push out. The object will the sensors fitted with the door will detect the movement of the object and accordingly perform the desired action. So that is what the inversion of control, or IOC. IOC implementation comes from dependency injection. IOC is a broad theoretical concept, but actual implementation has been done with the help of DI, or dependency injection. So if you look at the word itself, means you are injecting some dependencies. So what is that dependency? The invocation or the activation of the called function by the calling function. And initially, the primary work was done by University of Colorado in the US. So we took the example, same the last time, the concept of dependency injection. Now we'll go for the second example, that is setter-based dependency injection. So we can see it on the slide. We are designing a two Java classes here, and one is a XML class. The first Java class is a Hello World, second is a main app, and third is a beans.xml. Now, beans.xml will always remain there because in the class path XML application context, we'll always make use of the beans.xml, and this is one of the major module provided by the Spring framework. So in the Hello World class, we define the function like get message, the get message one, set message, and the set message one. Why I've defined it twice? Because we are doing it for two beans. So a pair of getter and setter function twice. for each of the two beans. Then we come to the main application, which will have a main function inside it, and it will make a call to the get bean function twice for two beans. First is a bean one and the second is a bean two. Then comes our main file, the beans.xml. It will have the XML definition of two beans. And it primarily will perform the task of invocation of the getter and the setter function of the hello world class from the beans.xml. So first file which we look into is main app, followed by beans.xml, followed by the hello world. That's how the flow of the program will take place. So we can see here, first of all, get bean will make a call to the beans.xml. Control will transfer from the main application to the beans.xml. Then it will make a call to the setter function, which have been defined within the hello world function. Because hello world class, hello world is a main class that will have a definitions for all these getter and setter functions. So that is how the control will flow on. We'll have the two beans, get bean one and bean two, which will be defined in the bean.xml. How it will be called? It will be called from the main application program. And this beans.xml file will make sure that it triggers the getter and the setter functions. Now within this function, we'll perform certain file writing operations, how to write the content into the file. Using a Spring framework, if I want to create a file, then what should I do or what code is to be written? So the traditional Java code we'll use for writing the file operation within the Hello World program. Now let's see the program in the Eclipse environment. So are we able to see the Eclipse? Anmol, is it visible on the screen? Fine. So if you look at the program, we are going to have the two main Java classes and one beans.xml. So we discuss the first main Java class that talks of the main application. So we start with the traditional importing of the packages of the Spring framework.
दूसरा नंबर पे भी आया था अभी किसी और बंदे ने करा था कस्टमर केयर वाले को पैसा आड़ा
सो वी से इंपोर्ट org.springframework.context.application.context देन इंपोर्ट org.springframework.context.support.class.path.xml.application.context सो वी कॉल्ड एज अ cpath क्लास पाथ एक्सएमएल एप्लीकेशन कॉन्टेक्स्ट दिस इज वन ऑफ द मेजर एक्सएमएल एप्लीकेशन कॉन्टेक्स्ट बिकॉज़ द एक्सएमएल डॉट दिस एक्सएमएल क्लास विल बी कॉल्ड ओनली इफ यू आर इंपोर्टिंग this particular package of the Java. Now this is all possible only if I imported all the reference libraries in the Java. So make sure our all reference libraries are already present. I have shared them. So I hope it is available with you also. If it is not, then download it from the Google. So here I am using the Spring 5.1.0 libraries. But the programs here defined are having the backward compatibility. So even if you're using a Spring 4 libraries, the program will work. Even if you are using the Spring 3.5 plus libraries, even then the program will work. Below 3 years, it will create a problem because the support has not been provided for the class for XML application part. But 3.2 or 3.3 and above, the support has been there. So there should not be any problem. Now we come to the main application and we define the main function, public static void main, string args, and we make a call to the one argument constructor of the XML application context, so class path XML application context. Now what it will do, it will try to search for the existence of the bean.xml file. So if it has been found, fine, it will return us the information and we are going to store it into a application context class variable called as a context. So for this, our bean.xml should be in the ready state. I will just show you the code of the bean.xml, but since the file exists, it will not throw any problem as such. Now, if it is available, we use a context reference variable and we make a call to the getBean function. Now, this getBean function, since we are using a two beans in this program, we first of all make a call to bean one with the help of this function. Then again, we make a call to the bean two. So, getBean bean one and the getBean bean two. It's a function. Gateway is the name of the function, the application context class. So we are invoking it with the help of the application context class variable called with the context. Now we need to typecast it because that is what is mandatory in the Spring framework. So we need to typecast as per the name of the class where getter and setter function have been defined. So that is hello world. So we specify the name of the hello world. And the return value will be stored into a variable object one and object two. Now we make a call to the function getMessage and the getMessage as getMessage and the getMessage one, which have been defined within the hello world dot Java class. Now we come to the beans.xml. Now this is one of the major non-Java XML class in the Spring framework, and it's very important that it should be correctly defined. So I will advise you when I create the program, do not change anything in the prologue section of the Spring framework, because everything has to be written as it is. The moment anything changes here and there, it will not be able to connect to the Spring framework, and it will not be able to provide you the features and functionality. So first of all, we define the XML version, then beans XML namespace, then identifier, then schema location, and then the entire URL. Here we can see it is 3.0 plus. So even if you have imported the libraries of 3.0 or 4.0, 5.0, the Spring program should work successfully fine. From the line number 8 to the line number 14, we can see we have written the code for the two tags, the two bean tags. First code is for the bean 1 and second code is for the bean 2. Now for the bean 1, the referencing class, we are using it package name dot class name. So usict dot hello world. And then we specify a property tag, the name becomes the attribute, and we specify the message. So since we are using the two messages here, so message and the message one. Now to the first message, we specify the value as GDSIP USICT. And to the second message, we just pass any numeric value, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4. So what we are doing here, just to precise and summarize, the line number 8 to 14, we are defining two beans, bean 1 and bean 2. And we are invoking the two specific messages, message and message one. Message one message has been initialized to a string GGSIP USICT, and the message one has been initialized with the value 1, 2, 3, 4. And the referencing classes are both referencing classes are the hello world class within the same package, USICT package. So we move to the hello world class. So this becomes a hello world class. Now here, since we're dealing with two messages, message and the message one, that means we'll have a two pair of the getter and the setter function. What do we do with the first one? So here we see this, we write the code for the first set message function. We see it will receive a message. So it is receiving a message from the beans.xml. Just further pass beans.xml, we have always TGSIP, USICT, we have seen, shown there. The message will be received here. Any problem arises, it will be handled by the corresponding exception classes. If the message is received, we are already ready with our own variable. So this refers to the current class, the instance of the current class. So this dot message is equal to message. So incoming value of the message goes here, and our class variable message receives that particular value. Now, as we discussed earlier while seeing the PowerPoint slide, we are going to create a file here. So what do? We make a call to the one argument constructor of the file writer class and specify the name of the file where we would like to perform the writing operation. So we say Java programming output.txt. And if there is any problem, it will immediately throw an exception. If everything is fine, we will receive the information about the file in the file writer class reference variable called fw. Now we start with the for loop, for and I is equal to 0, I less than the message name function and the I plus plus. So we start with the first character, go on till we have covered the entire content of the file. And for every character, what we do, we make a call to the write function of the file writer class. So we say fw.write, then message dot char add function, and we pass the value of I. Initially, first time the for loop iterate, I becomes 0. Then I 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 till it reaches to the end of the file. When the entire content of the file gets written, we see system auto print and then writing becomes successful, and we close down the file because that is what we say to write file reading and writing operations are. So file gets successfully written, based on the content which have been passed from the Beams.xml. Now we can also see the message which has been given to us by the Beams.xml. So system.out.println, your message is, and the name of the message you get displayed there. Now we come to the other pair of the getter and setter function, which is simple here, not much coding has been done. So first function is the set message one. It receives the value, which is value 1, 2, 3, 4, a numeric value, which we have, you can see here. It's simple value 1, 2, 3, 4. And then we receive it and initialize our message one variable. And then we make a call to the get message one function and we display the same message here, the value 1, 2, 3. That completes our program for the setter-based dependency injection, where we make use of three programs, two Java files and one XML file. One of the Java file will have a getter and setter function definitions. Another Java file will have a main function from wherein it will make a call to the XML file. And within the XML file, we provide a definition for two beans, the bean one and the bean two, and we pass on the value file. So now our main program is the bean application.java. So we right click it over, run as, and the Java app. So it prints the statement writing successful. That means we have been successfully able to write it. And the message which has been passed from the beam.xml was GGS IP USICT. It has been written there. And the message was a numeric value 1234, which has also got successfully printed here. That is how the setter-based dependency injection programs work seamlessly between the multiple classes, two Java-based and one non-Java-based, that is the XML file. The only thing that might create a problem is regarding the library. So make sure we import the libraries well in advance before we execute any of these programs. Another thing which you need to remember, in the package, the Java file will come, and outside the package, the beans.xml will come. So this is something has to be taken care of. XML file is not a Java file, so it should not be included within the package. It will always be outside the package. So I hope the program is clear and we are able to understand it. Otherwise, recording has already been done, so we can go through the same and then we can relook at the steps again. So we should be comfortable if we need to. Now we come to the second part of the Spring framework that talks of the interaction with the databases. How does a JDBC can be integrated with the help of the Spring framework? Now here we need to design multiple number of the classes as well as the interfaces as well as the XML file. So it is a bit complex. Complex not in terms of the complexity of the program, but in terms of the number of the program and the classes which we need to do. Because we need to deal with interfaces also, we need to deal with XML files also, and then we need to handle the Java programs also. So I have just broadly arranged all of them within the PowerPoint. So I will just show the same thing so that you can understand and see it. Now this is how it goes, the Spring JDBC example. Now here we have taken a case study of student management system. It is performing the SQL operation for the student, like insertion of a record, modification of a record, deletion of a record, and so on and so forth. So it takes into account the classes which you can see. First is the main application.java. Second is student.java. So both of them are the Java classes. Third is the interface. That means it will be a collection of abstract functions. Then is the fourth Java class, student JDBC template. Then fifth is a student mapper.java. And then sixth is a beams.xml file. So that is what around six programs of six classes, or rather six files we need to handle for handling the Spring JDBC framework. Now we'll go into each and every of them one by one and try to understand why they have been created in the very first place in the Spring framework. Now, what will the main application.java do? As the name itself indicates, it will have a main function inside it. So for all these six programs, only one class, that is main app.java, will have a main function inside it. and it will also contain a function called get bean function. Just like in the previous setter based dependency injection program we have discussed, from the main app.java, we make a call to the context.get bean, and then we specify the name of the corresponding bean which should get invoked. So here we also will make a call to the get bean function, and we specify the name of the student JDBC template. You can just see in the Eclipse how it will work. Then we define a class called student.java. It should have two major things. First of all, whatever are the variables that are going to be used for performing the read write operation within the databases, they should be declared here. So let's say class like student ID, student name, student age, student address, his phone number, his email address, whatever you want to define for the case study, we can have to declare all these variables here. And then we'll have a multiple number of getter and setter functions. So if we have got four variables, we'll have a 8 getter and setter function. So a pair of getter and setter functions for all of the variables which have been declared within the class. Then we define an interface, student DAO data access object. Now, this is also part of the Spring framework, where what they have done, they have provided an interface, which is a collection of all the abstract functions which will be used to perform the CRUD operation in the database. CRUD is create, read, or receive, update, and delete operations within the databases as such. Then we define the next class, student JDBC template. This is a class that will contain the actual SQL code for performing the CRUD operation in the database. So create, receive, or read, update and delete operations within the databases. Then we need to have the class called student mapper. It will have a small line of code, hardly 8 7 to 8 lines of code will be there, and it is basically designed for invocation of the setter function, so the values can be enforced within the case studies as such. And then finally we'll have a beans.xml file, a non-java file that will contain the actual JDBC code for connecting the front end to the back end. So we specify the actual name of the MySQL driver class, the com.jdbc.driver.mysql driver, and the port number 2206, and the name of the database, and the user ID, and the password. Everything will be specified in the beans.xml file as such. Now, beside these six things, seventh thing which you need to do, create a table, which I have not written here, within the databases, because then only the entire things will get successfully performed. The rules will be fetched by the rules will be created by the user, stored into a database, and then fetched from the database to the front end. So another thing which we need to do, create a table within the database, which is not written here. It is only written for the front end programming language. They won't need to be done in the front end. Back end, we need to make sure our back end is ready, MySQL with a table, so that the entire reading and writing operations can be seamlessly performed from the front end to the back end. Now, stopping the sharing of the content of the PPT, and then we switch over to the Eclipse. So is the Eclipse visible? Can we start the discussion on the program? Okay, fine. So we can see the file organization on the left hand side of the package, left hand side in the package explorer window. Now this is essential because when you are doing the same thing on your machine, make sure the files are organized in the same manner. Otherwise, you will not be able to see the output of the program. Neither program will work seamlessly fine. So we need to make sure it works perfectly on our system also. So first thing I have done here is I've created a package. I've created a folder by the name Spring JDBC. Within that, I've created a pack called JDBC pack package. Now these are all the classes. One of them is interface. I can see small I written here over here, which is the interface. And remaining four are all the Java classes. Then a beans.xml within the outside the package as such, because that is something which is not part of the Java, so it has to be stored and created outside the package. Now first thing, come to the main application.java. Now we can see here we'll have the main application, and just like we discussed in the previous program, first thing we need to make sure that we instantiate and make a call to the one argument constructor of the class path XML application context. Now, and we specify the name of the XML file, because that's the very first line which is always written within the main function of the string field. Search for the XML file where the XML file is. If you're not able to search for the XML file, or if the XML file cannot be located, the program functionality will stop here itself. It will not proceed further. So first thing it will always do is search for the beans.xml file. And our beans.xml file is ready, in the ready state. So we can look at the code for this beans.xml file. The first part goes as an XML prologue section. So this has to be written as it is. So no major brainstorming has to be done here. It is something provided by the string.org. So it has to be carried forward directly as it is. So we specify the version of the XML, then XML namespaces, then identifiers, then schema location, and followed by the URL, which is currently being used as 3.0 onwards, 3.0 access identifiers. Now, once that has been done, now comes the code of the programmer from the line number 7 to the line number 14. Now, what we are doing here, we are defining an ID called data source, a bean ID. Now, this data source will be referenced in our case study. Whenever you would like to establish a connection from the front end to the back end, will trigger this data source, which is a bean ID we are creating. Now, what we do here in the next line of code, that is line number 9, we make a call to the driver manager class. So we say org.springframework.jdbc.datasource.driverManagersDataSource. Now, this is a predefined class. It has to be called as it is. It's equivalent of the JDBC class, what we call class.forName, and then the driver manager.getConnection. Everything will be done by this specific class. So it need to be written as it is. Now, this data source, make sure, is being referred in the entire case study without any problem. Now, we specify four properties here. First is a name, then URL, username, and the password. The first property name, whose attribute is the driver class name, we specify the name of the driver. So, com.mysql.jdbc.driver. So, name of the database driver which I want to connect to. So if I'm using Oracle, oracle.jdbc.driver.oracle-driver as such. So it depends on, and I hope everyone is now comfortable doing so much of the programming, but this is the only thing we keep on changing as and when our database changes. Then we specify the URL, and we specify the entire string that is specified for the MySQL. So jdbc colon MySQL colon 2 forward slash, then is the IP address or the location where server exists for the MySQL. Since it is existing on my machine, so I specified local host. If it doesn't work, fine, 127.0.0.1, that is something which we need to specify. Then we specify the port number 3306, which is the default port number for the MySQL. If I'm using Oracle, it is 1521. Then we specify the name of the database. Since I was already doing using a database for the employee in another case study, I've used the same database as such. But we can create another database and store it there. So case study is a student case study, but the name of the database which I'm using is an employee. And I've created a table there only. Then we specify the username and the password which we are going to use for connection from the front end to the back end. That is, the username becomes 2 and the password becomes reverse of a TWRS. So our code should be ready right in the very first place before we connect the JDBC database from the Spring framework. So this beans.xml is a very important file from that point of view, where the connection is being established from the front end to the back end. If at any point of time, if there's any problem, so just check this file first. Is everything written fine? Or is there any uppercase, lowercase problem, or the port number problem, or the corresponding database problem, or maybe the name of the driver class problem is there? Because that's the main file that Spring Framework uses for establishing the connection from the front end to the back end as such. So I will be mailing this program to you. I will mail the program to Anmol. We will forward it to you. So depending on the database which you are using, make sure corresponding changes are being done here, so that you can execute the program easily without any problems. Now we come back to the main application.java, the place from where we came to the beans.xml file. Now, once the beans.xml file is there, then we can move forward, and it talks of another thing called as a context.getv student JDBC template. That means it is triggering up another thing called as student JDBC template. So let's switch over from this program to the all the classes one by one, because ultimately we come back to the main application. So first thing first, we come to the main student.java. Now this is a class that identifies which case study you are working on. Since you're working on a student case study, we'll have the variables like age, name, ID. Rather, even if I'm dealing with the employee, I can have the same attributes as such. So that's possible. So I can add it or delete it as per my requirement as. But this is the main class that should be there in all the Spring JDBC framework case studies which deal with it. Now, since we have got three variables here, so we can have the six number of the setter and the getter function in student.java. So we'll see set age, get age, then set name, get name, and then set ID and the get ID as such. So we'll have the multiple number of getter and setter function, and that depends upon the number of variables which I'm using within my main class, that is student.java. That is the main backbone class of the entire Spring JDBC case study. Then we come to the interface called Student Data Access Object Interface. Now this is an interface which expects us to define multiple number of the function which we are using in this entire case study. So all these functions which we are using, the abstract body declaration, abstract function declaration, is being made available here as such. So here we use set data source, create function, the get student function, the list student function, a delete function, because these are the functions which we are going to define within the JDBC template.java. So abstract blank body definition of all these functions is being available within the student DAO or data access object. Then we come to the next class, student JDBC template.java. Now what will this class definition do? First of all, it will implement the student DAO, student data access object, because this is already available with us, so it will not show any problem as such. And all those abstract functions which were declared within that interface will now be defined within this class, and this class is already implementing the interface, so we can always do that without any problem. So you look at the data source is made available, then we can insert a record, so we override a create function, the function declaration is already present in the interface, so we write a SQL query, insert into table name, and we pass on the values dynamically at the runtime. Same way we go for the other function. If I want to fetch the values, so we override the getStudent function. And since it's a getter function, we need to specify the ID on which ID the record will be fetched. Then if I want to iterate and list the total number of the records within the table of the database, so we just write the query select star from table name as such. And then we use the iterator, which is a list, which is of the type student, the name of the class. And it refers to the JDBC template object, and it can easily execute the query and fetch the records as such. If you want to delete the particular record as such, you make a call to the override the delete function. The abstract declaration is already present in the interface, and then I can easily write my own code, which specific record I would like to delete. I would like to delete all the records or any few of the records as such. And then for that, I will make a call to the update function, pass the string, which is SQL, delete from table name where ID, and when this function will be called, the corresponding ID will be passed here, and the record will be deleted from the table of the database as such. And if you want to perform any update operation, we all know there is the SQL query update table name, set column name is equal to question mark, where column name is equal to question mark. So here we set the age and ID is this. So when this function will be called, it will receive two things here, the ID and the age. And then dynamically at the runtime, we'll make a call to the update function and specify the entire SQL string, which is update table name, set column name is equal to question mark, where column name is equal to question mark. And now we have received the two values, the age and the ID. So these actual values will replace the question mark during execution at the runtime. And if the records are updated, we'll see an updated record with ID is equal to, and the corresponding ID will be displayed. That is how typically student JDBC template.java will work. And these case studies are common across the Spring framework as such. They are the basic backbone for the Spring framework. And then it provides the option to us as a programmer that we can extend or modify or enhance these case studies as well. Even you will find a similar case study on spring.org also. So the majority of the Spring sites are dedicated to these case studies. Then comes the last class that talks of the student mapper.java. Now this is a small class where it will first of all make sure to whatever function I want to define. Like first of all, we instantiate the class that is in the class of line code number 9. Then we make a call to the function set IDs. So set ID, set name, and the set age. So all these functions will be called one by one, and the corresponding values will be enforced or passed here. So that they are being passed on successfully to the student.java as such. So once we have seen all these classes, now we go to the main function, that is main.app.java, and we can execute the program and see the output on our system. So if everything is all fine and well, so we can see here a record has been loaded. Since we are using com.mysql.jdbc or driver, it is a deprecated one. So it will show that it will not show any error. It will show a warning. This need to be replaced as such. Then the records are created. So we can see the record which have been created. Then listing of the records from the table of the database, which we all, it will get listed into the front end. And then we perform certain updation operation for record IDs too. So accordingly, the record will get modified. And then the entire program will get successfully executed. That is how typically the Spring framework interacts with the databases using a JDBC as such. It's not that complex also, but it spans across a multiple number of the classes and the interfaces as such. That is something which you need to take care of when we are doing it in our own systems as such. So I will mail the program, make sure we do it today itself, because if you postpone for tomorrow, day after tomorrow, half of the things will forget. The best thing is boot the program today itself and everything works fine seamlessly on your system too as such. So that is all from my side for today's Spring class. If you have any doubt, then you can always take up the questions. And any doubt with anyone? I hope it's all clear. Information about the project. I hope the project we are able to cope, because hardly 1 week is left. So make sure format, I think Vedha or Monica or Anmol would have mailed and would have received by now. That is a broad format covering everything. Application, website development, and the research-based case study. Make sure we confine to that format. Don't try to create something new. Yes,